The man is racist. His parents were rich. They had an emerald mine in South Africa. Exploitation of our own people, of black people. Like, there's no ethical billionaire in the world. Not
so. News broke out on social media that South African billionaire has overtaken Nigerian billionaire Aliko Dangote. And trust me, some South Africans could not wait to come out and start jubilating. You know, this back and forth between Nigerians and South Africans.
South African businessman and also the man who's part of the Stellenbosch Mafia, Johann Rupert, has finally overtaken Aliko Dangote to be the richest man in Africa. Now, there's a portion of South Africans that are saying that they are proud of Johann because he's South African. And to those people, I just have one question. Why would you be proud of Johann while he owns Anglo Gold, which is a company that was built on the backs of black South Africans during apartheid?
Anyway, there's a young lady who came out to school Nigerians and others who care to listen about the wealth of, you know, rich people and, you know, what comes with it and how they attained and how they got there. She was also saying that why do people glorify rich people? Why? And I'm thinking also because you see these people coming outside on social media to come and glorify the rich people. Oh, he's so rich. Oh, we have someone in Africa, someone in South Africa who is richer than someone in Nigeria. We have someone in Nigeria who is richer than someone in, you know, South Africa. Who is doing the math? So anyway, let's just read this that came with the information about the South African billionaire. South African billionaire Johann Rupert overtakes Aliko Dangote as Africa's richest person. Johann Rupert, South African billionaire and chairman of Richemont, a luxury goods conglomerate, has overtaken Aliko Dangote, chairman of Dangote Industries Limited, as Africa's richest person. According to the latest data from Bloomberg Billionaire Index, Rupert's net worth has surged to $14.3 billion, overtaking Dangote, whose fortune has declined to $13.4 billion. I mean, if you look at the statistics, the difference is not that much, but a billion plus is a big deal, right? Anyway, I don't want to bore you guys so much with the details. I'm just going to leave it on my screen for you guys to read and see for those that are interested. Now to the juicy part of this video. This young lady came and schooled those that needed to be schooled. She schooled Nigerians and beyond on these rich people and people glorifying them for just, you know, why? Anyway, let's go listen to her and, you know, I'll be back with my thoughts.
I was on live, like, it was a long time ago, and I was actually shocked that a bunch of people did not know that Dangote came from a wealthy family. From the start, I never even knew that there was a rags to riches story. Let me just be the one to tell you guys now. There is no billionaire that exists that is not exploiting other people, that did not come from previous money. You can never make it from the grass to the grace of billionaire unless you become an evil fucking bitch.
You guys, you're listening to her and you're hearing right now. Do you agree with her? Like, before someone can become a billionaire, it takes generational wealth. Like, they didn't just suddenly come out from nowhere and just become a billionaire, except you are, you know, just the word she said, something bitch, meaning that you're grinding hard, you're grinding crazily. I mean, let's go back and keep listening to her.
The glorification of billionaires in Nigeria that contribute to the literal poverty that exists in Nigeria is so insane to me. You will never be Otedola. You will never be Dangote. And those people will never help you. I feel like a lot of people cannot conceptualize how much money billionaires have and how inhumane the amount of money they have is. And before anybody comes and start talking about, oh, they have charity, charities are a tax write-off. Literally, everyone has charities not because they want to help people, but because it gives them an opportunity to write off part of the taxes that they are paying if they are even paying any in Nigeria. Religion will not save Nigeria. Tribalism will not save Nigeria. Homophobia will not save Nigeria, and classism, the worst of the worst of all, will not save Nigeria. White supremacy will not save Nigeria. I'm tired of you guys lick assing. Like, the way I see Nigerians kiss white people ass, like, it's actually embarrassing for a group of people who run around on the internet so prideful. Jesus, stand up! Elon Musk's parents were rich. I don't know why people even carry that man on your head. The man is racist. His parents were rich. They had an emerald mine in South Africa, exploitation of our own people, of black people. Like, there is no ethical billionaire in the world. Not Rihanna, not Beyonce, not nobody. Stop kiss-assing rich people that don't give a fuck about whether you live or die next tomorrow, as long as it's not affecting their bank account. We need to band together and focus on ourselves. People that are talking about splitting the country, how do you think, where the fuck do you people think the government spawns from? Do you think the government is just some evil entity somewhere? Our society is consistently producing these evil people because our society itself is so fucking evil. Schools are not free from corruption. Even in the family, the power dynamics in the nuclear family of Nigeria is so fucked. Everybody is power hungry, money hungry, and selfish and greedy as fuck. Everybody's ready to step on everybody to get to some useless goal that is not attainable. From a group of people that came from communism to now glorifying capitalism, I don't know how you guys think capitalism is ever going to work in our favor. It has never worked in our favor. Until you people realize that we are the commodity, we as black people, number one, we are the commodity, our resources are the commodity, and if you are now poor as a black person, your labor is the commodity. We are literally fighting for minimum wage, I believe, 30,000 naira. Imagine 30,000 naira per month. Meanwhile, a bag of rice is 80k. Let's be so fucking for real. Let us be so fucking for real. Please, I don't know what kind of delusion, what kind of sleep we are sleeping, but it's time to wake the fuck up. Churches are still making money, even in this recession. Offering, people are still going to church to be giving offering at 10% of it. God is not coming to save you. Rapture is not coming. You are making the rapture happen by doing all this nonsense, sitting back down and going to be praying. Prayer is not going to help. I'm sorry if you're religious. Cry. It's not going to do nothing. Your forefathers have been praying to the same colonialist God that they brought them all these years. And Nigeria has only gotten consistently worse. Please, like, let's stop all this mumu behavior. I'm sick and I'm tired. Celebrities will not save you. They will not. In fact, they will throw you inside the fire if it's going to increase 10 in their bank account. They don't give a fuck.
All right. Are we even ready for this conversation? I'm sure a lot of people will not agree with her. Okay, so I agree with most of the things she said. And the prayer part also, we just need to be very, very wise, okay? I can't say there's a God, all right? Because if you're saying there's no God, what about the traditional people who believe in something and it works for them? So I want to believe that as far as the Christianity, you know, religion goes, there's a God. So I don't think there's anything wrong with praying. And for those that are comfortably, you know, comfortable with giving their tithes and offerings and whatever, it's fine. But I don't think that this is the time that, you know, we as Nigerians, as Africans, you know, you just put all your head when you're supposed to be trying to think of ways to, you know, better your life, better yourself, and then you're just sitting in a church. You know, I don't think this is the time for us to do that. Of course, we have Sundays that are there reserved for the church, but you see some Africans, you see some Nigerians that are still going, leaving their businesses in the name of, you know, they have a church service to attend. I mean, anyway, we're not even ready for this conversation. I don't want to even dabble into that, okay, too much. But I want you guys to feel free to leave your thoughts in the comment section with what she said. What do you think? I think she really went harder and deeper. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section, and I'll definitely see you guys in my next video. Bye for now.
I came from a wealthy family. My late great-grandfather in the 1940s was actually the richest West African. My late grandfather was one of the wealthiest Nigerian, you know, the family name is Dentata. That's from my maternal side. My father too, you know, was fairly rich, you know, but he was both, you know, in business and also in politics. But you know, David, one thing that I'm very, very proud of is that I did not inherit any money from my father. I built everything from scratch to where I am. I started work with my, you know, uncle, but there's a few months, and then I went to Lagos, and now I started my own business by just, you know, buying cement, selling. You know, it was just a very low-key business. We are the largest cement manufacturer in sub-Saharan Africa.